touch-up, early life shocks in the Progresa experiment, and last but not least, the presentation of PIDS on unlocking the Filipino people's potential in the next 6 years and beyond by Dr. Vic Paqueo. But before we start with the presentations, we request our Vice President, Dr. Marife Ballesteros, for the opening remarks.
Good afternoon. Thank you for coming despite the rainy weather. Yes, and I will make this very brief because I know we have three presentations and we want to give more time for discussions and present the presentation for speakers. So, well, this is a very important topic. We know that investment in human capital through education is central to development policy. And we have had several evidence studies that shows the economic returns from investment in education in terms of long-term growth and productivity has been firmly established. So in the case of the Philippines, investment in education is also a core strategy for growth, for poverty reduction, and to address inequality. If we look at the budget, for education in the Philippines, that's about on the average 3.0% of GDP. Well, this is still comparatively lower if we compare it to the world average, which is about 4 to 5% of GDP, and still lower if you compare it, for instance, to Vietnam, which is about 5% of GDP. But if we look at our budgetary allocation, education actually remains at the top priority of government, second to the infrastructure budget for several years. And the share of education sector to the total budget in the Philippines has increased from 14% in 2010 to 20% in 2018, and this does not include the budget given to CCT. So in recent years, government has also been responsive in terms of putting greater efforts to accelerate human capital development by enhancing the quality of and access to education and training programs. And in the past, we have been, public policy has been focused on basic education. We are still focused on that, but we have acknowledged the importance of higher education for research and development and technological progress. So I believe that if you look at priorities, the Philippine government puts high priority to education or investment in human capital through education. I think the main challenge is really whether we have the right policies and processes to effectively implement our programs. For instance, are the programs or policies of education responding to changes in labor, in the labor market, and are we providing appropriate support or conditions for these programs? So this afternoon, we are fortunate to have with us a panel of experts from the World Bank, the University of Hawaii, and of course, the PIDS. So let me take this opportunity to welcome and thank our distinguished speakers who will provide the insights into the challenges and benefits of education programs and policies. So as mentioned by Rowena, Ms. Paliping, we have three studies to be presented today. One is an assessment of the Philippine Alternative Learning Program for out-of-school youth and adults. And the study will look at the effects of the program and the challenges that have to be addressed to improve program outcomes. The second would be a study. We will also learn from the Mexico's Progresa program, which is the landmark conditional cash transfer program that is targeted to children to face adverse events in early childhood. And this is very relevant in the case of the Philippines, which is, as we all know, is vulnerable, the third presentation by our own PIDS fellows is more forward-looking. It looks into the emerging fourth industrial revolution and how the country should prepare the workforce to respond to the changes in the patterns of production, to the demands for higher productivity, and of course, changes in terms of new industries and employment brought about by the fourth industrial revolution. So let me also take this time to welcome our distinguished guests, friends, colleagues from government, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your attendance, and let us look forward to a productive afternoon. So let me turn you over now to Ms. Filipino for the introduction of our speakers. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Ballesteros. Our first two speakers today are both from the World Bank. Let's give a hand to Senior Education Specialist, Ms. Takiko Igarashi, and to Senior Economist, Mr. Pablo Acosta.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much, first of all, PIDS, for giving us the opportunity to present our recent policy note, which is focused on the alternative learning system in the Philippines. What we are going to present, focus on today, is many of us, like maybe asking around ourselves, is LS is effective to develop the human capital and skills, especially targeting for those who are out of school, those who drop out of the basic educations. So my presentation will focus on these broad areas. So first of all, I will briefly touch on the international evidence, and also I'll explain the data and survey we conducted, and then also findings structured on the three broad areas: demand side challenges, supply side challenges, and also the benefit. So we will like to talk about a little bit about the returns to the LS. And then we conclude the presentation with some policy recommendations. The first of all, international evidence. There are many adult learning programs or non-formal education or home-based schooling. Out of basic formal school system, there are various kinds of non-formal education programs. So if we compare to the research on the formal education system, actually the international evidence is rather thin. And then if we try to look for the positive evidence, the result is a bit mixed. Even though there are a couple of nice, strong evidence in the developing countries context, but largely compared to the formal education research, the evidence is very thin. So why is that? The research are telling us the three broad areas for the as a common key challenges. The first of all, this training program is targeting for the adults or those who are already in the labor market. So they have a very high opportunity cost for the attending those learning interventions. So they have to give up some wages that could have been earned to attend the learning sessions or miss the child care, or for the farmers, they have to be in the farm for the whole day during the day, and then it's very challenging for them to come to the learning interventions. And secondly is related to our brain, how brain works for the adults. The research is telling that adults, ourselves, we do learn, we do develop new concepts in our brain, but our brain does not work as children and also early adolescents. But the recent evidence showed that adults can develop the synapses in the brain, but sadly, like those new learnings can be rapidly depreciating. And the third key challenge is about the uncertainty of attending this learning intervention. For example, like I'm close to age 40, so at age 40, I'm attending the new learning intervention. Am I getting a higher income, or am I getting a better employment prospects? I don't know. These are the key areas for the a key challenge for the specific to the adult learning programs. But there are also such suggestion from the recent study, the common principles to overcome these key challenges. I don't go detail today, but if you are interested, you can go to the listed study later on. So to conduct this study, like we conceptualized in 2013, and then we implemented a series of the survey. But the one of the significant challenge is the data. So of course, maybe some of you already noticed, but if you think of the ALS learners, they are the school dropouts. They are maybe in the school system. So it's really difficult for the official data to correctly capture them and track them how they are doing. So even though DEPED has made good efforts to collect the data, but if we try to do a meaningful analysis, the quality was not necessarily sufficient. So we designed this series of data. So later on, if the PIDS colleagues are interested in data, I'm happy to consult and share the detail and maybe share maybe data set if those who are needed. Even though many of us already know about what ALS, but I'd like to touch on the key facts. So that ALS is a government program managed by government and also regulated by the government and delivered by the learning facilitators. Those are like a teacher in the classroom. Those include employees of the DEPED and also service providers contracted by DEPED using the official budget. And then also the learning demand for the ALS learner is quite different. And then the learning is tailored to the different needs of the enrolled learners in the ALS. And the important thing is if the learners wants to take the exam and then pass the exam, the official certificate can be earned. So with that official certificate, they can be regarded as equivalent as a high school graduate or the elementary graduate. So this diagram is showing the brief structure of the ALS. So not just the general academic contents, but also it covers some skills training, focus on the content-specific occupational skills training or the livelihood training programs. But those training programs is not independent programs, but rather delivered to those who are in the basic literacy program or ALE, accreditation and equivalence programs. So let's look at the data now. So who are the ALS learners? So ALS learners include the school dropouts and above school age and those who are already out of the school system. So using the recent National Household Survey, we can use this characteristic and estimate it is around 6.6 million for among the age 15 to 30 years old. And in 2017, DEPED official data said about 600,000 people are actually registered for the ALS. And all age accepted, but our data shows that the program is really appealing to the young people, young adults in 20s. And also the prior learning attainments, the education attainments prior to joining the ALS, they are mostly like those who have some high school education. They registered, enrolled in a high school, but dropped out in the middle. And the target population I mentioned, 6.6 million, can be eventually declined if we continue our effort to improve the formal education system, but the process, at least that we estimated, the process will be very slow or very take long time if we keep the current pace improving the formal education due to the population growth in the country. Okay, now let's move on to the demand side challenges for the ALS. Demand side challenges faced by the learners. So if you are out of school, you are registered for the ALS and then attended regularly the learning session and complete the learning and then sign up for the A&E exam and then pass the exam eventually. How quickly those initial number can be depreciated along the way. So DEPED has been a good effort. In the recent 5 years, we have seen the good progress, good growth in terms of the enrollers of the ALS. at the key performance, we cannot really compare with the basic education, but the performance is still limited. For example, participation rate is still less than 10% of the LS young prospective learners. And then out of those, 60% is regularly attended throughout the intervention period. Intervention period goes every year, 10 months a year. And then out of the initially, those who are initially enrolled, 20% or less than 20% are actually passing the ALE exam. So if we think of the initial pie, the pie is getting smaller and smaller, rather rapidly. And then also, we cannot forget the regional disparities. If you look at the key indicators for the autonomous region from Sri Mindanao, the participation is very low already, and then out of that, the AMD passing rate is less than 1%. So we conducted the data with the actual learners, those who enrolled in the LS. We tried to find out who are likely performing well in the LS. So we found that once those are enrolled in the LS, they are more likely to attend. If they attend the LS session regularly, they're more likely to complete and take the exam and then pass the exam eventually. There is a strong correlation between those stages. Maybe this is intuitive. And then also we conducted simple regression, and then we found that the enrollees who are male and who are also younger in the age are likely to discontinue or stop in the middle. And then also prior education attainment is very important to suggest the performance in the ALS. Those who had at least some high school education are likely to survive in the ALS and then eventually pass the exam. And then learners in the remote area showing more difficulty, but they are trying to complete more than those peers in the urban areas, but less motivated to get the official certificate in the ALS. And how about opportunity cost for them? So we tried to ask how many of them out of the learners are actually working and how many hours they devote for the attending the ALS. So actually we found that the 60% of them are employed for the wage paying job. And then others are not, others are also engaged in the unpaid tasks or the child cares. And then attendance, more than half, if they are regularly attending, more than half are showing up at least twice or three times weekly. And then working hours is also reduced to attend the LS sessions. And also, surprisingly, they're not just studying twice or three times a week, but also outside of LS, they spend some time for the self-study or talking to teachers or peer learning or reading materials or doing some numeracy activities. Now, we switch to the focus to the supply side. So delivery of the ALS, it's actually implemented in various locations across the countries. Sometimes, you know, like indigenous community or in a very urban settings in a very remote island. So the delivery of ALS is naturally very complex, as it needs to be responsive to the different localities. In this section, we'd like to focus on four key blocks in the supply side. One, operational expenses, second, learning materials, and then third, learning centers and monitoring arrangement. So the operational expenses to deliver for the learning facilitators, most of them are paying. In the survey, we asked the facilitators to report each item's frequency and then also amount they spend. So on the average, it's very difficult to generalize, but we tried to come up with a simple average. Simple average showing that 1,100 peso weekly basis they are spending for the transport to deliver, or for the basic, And then most of them are spending for the transportation, because the operating just at the school, but they have to go to the areas. Naturally, that those facilitators who are in the remote areas, where the population is less widely spread out, their transportation is more expensive than the urban peers. And then after they spend for transportation, the basic stationery, basic items like papers and inks and paper folder, only very little amount is left to buy instruction materials or the supplemental learning materials. The total cost is by far exceeding the amount they receive from the deathbed. I just had one simple benchmark computed from the school MOE for the high school. So 1,100 is a bit more or less equivalent to the amount the pay at the not really paid to the teacher, but the spend if we come up with the average for the per teacher at the high school. And then also the next supply side items is the learning modules. So LS is basically the self-learning, self-instructional courses. So the availability of the LS learning modules is still a persistent challenge on the ground. So we asked the facilitators, and then they reported about 70% of the facilitators reported that they don't have enough learning modules on the ground. Only 60% have at least one set of the complete set of the modules, but the rest, 70% didn't receive any modules from the deathbed. And then for the adults, as we saw, the adult's brain, how it works is different from the children. So adults requires more practice to learn this new concept in the brain, so it requires more practice, but our survey showing that only one out of the three active learners can take home the learning materials for the self-study. So this is quite critical for the adult learners. The next, learning facilities, learning environment. So the learning, this graph is showing the proportion of the types of the facility used for the LS. As you can see, there is a clear contrast between the remote areas and urban areas. The remote area, dominant facilities are the type 1, type 2. Type 1 is open air learning space. Type 2 is a very basic structure with the light materials like a bipa or softwood. And type 3 and type 4, type 5 is a concrete structure with type 5 with a concrete structure with a secured learning resource like a library and also ICTs. So as we go high, then the facilities are well equipped. So the sharp contrast we can see in the urban area and the remote area. And the simple regression we conducted showing that the well-equipped facilities are strongly associated with the attendance, also completion and passing of the A&E test. And also the international research showed that adults are really sensitive to the environment and the noise when we learn things. So maybe this is suggesting maybe we can suggest the deputy to maximize the use of the public school that are relatively better equipped on the ground and also strategically located. So now let's look at the monitoring arrangement for the LS. So unlike the school system, so LS facilitators are independent. So go to meet the learners independently with, it's like a taxi driver. So how to arrange the supervision is very challenging, but also very costly, but very important. The current supervision mechanism, this graph is showing how frequently the facilitators are monitored by the contract type of the learning facilitators. Largely, it can be divided to two groups. One is DEPED employees, DEPED delivered facilitators. The other one is the service providers contracted by service DEPED. So those who are contracted by DEPED are less frequently monitored. But if we think of the natural incentives mechanism in our mind, DEPED employees are already embedded in the DEPED system. They're regularly motivated because they have a career progression in mind. But the contract providers are less monitored, but there are maybe more those who are more required more monitoring or supervision. So that delivery, arranging the supervision in the LS setting is very difficult. One way to do it maybe to think of like some incentive mechanism so that it can be managed very well. The last point in our presentation is about the benefit of or outcome of the ALS. So the learners are actually benefiting from ALS. The data is showing the value of the ALS certificate for the employment further education can be very high. But if we look at that graph, it's depending on whether you can pass the A&E exam or not. So if the for the passers for the A&E exam, around 60% are going further education or technical vocational training or informal training, skills training. But if you don't pass, the proportion is very low. And also for the employment after ALS, for those who pass the A&E exam, the employment incidence, employment opportunity for the formal sector is twice as large as those who didn't pass the A&E exam. But the last point. So ALS is generally focusing on developing the competencies and skills in the general academics. But our recent study is showing the important role of the non-cognitive, non-academic skills called social-emotional skills. So our data, we conducted household survey in the workforce population in the Philippines. Our data is showing the Filipino in the workforce who are less educated scored poorly on the social-emotional skills traits, especially grit, decision-making, agreeableness, and extroversion, as compared to those who have more than high school graduate. And the one standard deviation increase in the social emotional skills trait is associated of 9% of the increase in the daily average earnings. Particularly, the increase is large for those who are less educated. So this comes to our conclusion of our study. So our study has shown various challenges faced by ALS, and then maybe good news and maybe not so good news about the outcomes of the ALS, but we want to also stress this point. ALS has a potential for enabling the enrollers or out of school youth to bring them back to the past so that they can develop the human capital and skills. We didn't measure increased learnings or increased skills in the ALS, but if they pass the A&E exam in the ALS, they are more likely to go back to the school, to the formal education or additional skills, vocational training, or better employment. But we need to remember that this pass, we are seeing the very low pass rate still in the ALS. The program may not be fully effective, especially those areas where we don't see major accomplishments like ARM. So ALS is a very large and a complex program. We have mentioned many issues or challenges in the delivering ALS or challenges faced by the learners. Of course, it is very important to address these challenges, but because of this program and its implication is large, so it's very important to have rigorous monitoring and evaluation before designing, crafting the policy interventions. So our study is not really recommending the specific policy measures, but we'd like to somehow suggest areas that the policy can focus on. The first one is to support learners to cope with high opportunity cost for the enrollers. Maybe including the maximize using the public school facilities, use of the technologies, or better information dissemination. The second area include to cope with the uncertainty of the economic returns. Maybe A&E exam can be delivered in more efficient manner, and then context-specific skills training can incentivize the learners to stick to the learnings. And the third area is to alleviate financial operation bottlenecks, as we saw on the supply side. It's really important to address critical shortage, but we need to do it in a very efficient manner. And then effective delivery model can be reconsidered with strong monitoring incentive mechanism. And also it's important to focus on the disparities in the LS quality, particularly in ARN. And eventually in the midterm and long term, it's very important to assess the relevance and increase the relevance of the LS learning contents. As we look at the low passing rate, it may be suggesting something. It's maybe possible to assess the competencies and skills and motivation of the LS learners and then check if the current system is matching their expectation. And then lastly, we would like to stress that it's very important to improve the synergy on the ground between the LS alternative delivery mode implemented in the school and also formal school, so that the student at the risk, but while they are in school, they can be supported by teacher to prevent them from totally leaving the school. So it's very important for us to support the government so that they can keep the good efforts in improving the K-12 system. And then also the support, they can support that the students who are at risk before they leave the school system. Thank you very much for listening, and then I would appreciate if you can share your thoughts and questions so that we can perhaps take on for the next. And then again, if you're interested in a more detail about our analysis and then our data, please feel free to contact me and Pablo. And thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Ms. Igarashi, for giving us an overview of how we are failing in terms of ALS. Now for the second presenter, he is an assistant professor at the University of Hawaii, and she's here to present her study on helping children catch up early life shocks and Progresa, and the Progresa experiment. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Teresa Molina.
Documenting that early life circumstances matter a lot. And to be a little bit more specific about this, I mean that the health conditions that we're exposed to in utero or in early childhood have long-run implications for our adult outcomes, our adult health outcomes, education outcomes, and labor market outcomes. And as I've already mentioned, there is evidence from both the medical literature, epidemiological literature, and now growing evidence from the economic literature that really emphasizes the importance of these early life circumstances. Now, an important question then for researchers as well as for policymakers is whether remediation is possible for those who are hit by these negative early life shocks in utero or in childhood. So can schools, can governments, can parents, can they do anything to help these children catch up with the rest of their peers? And if so, what types of interventions can generate this catch-up? And I want to be clear right now what I mean when I say catch-up or what I mean when I say an intervention can generate remediation. I simply mean that an intervention generates remediation or catch-up if it helps those who are hit by negative shocks early on more than it helps those that are not. Right? And so kind of armed with this understanding, our research question then in this paper is looks at a specific type of intervention, specifically Mexico's conditional cash transfer program, Progresa. And it asks whether these types of conditional cash transfer programs, which children are exposed to, again, at in school age, so during, I guess, so elementary school, middle school age, whether an intervention like this can help remediate for disadvantage that's generated in the first year of life. And another way, actually, of thinking about or just framing this question is in terms of the returns to this conditional cash transfer program. So another way of thinking about this question is to ask, are the returns to this Progresa program increasing or decreasing in the initial endowment? And I'm going to use the term endowment a lot, and I'm just that just kind of refers to the level of health and skill that a child is born with, and so where the lower endowment child being kind of referring to the less healthy, less smart children. And so if the returns are decreasing in the initial endowment, that would mean there actually is quite a large scope for mitigation because Progresa is helping those kind of that are disadvantaged more. And I want to actually just take a moment to note that the answer to this question, it's not entirely theoretically obvious and it's not empirically straightforward to answer. And the reason, so theoretically, we can think of a framework where parents invest in their children at, you know, at various ages, and the returns to these investments vary over time. And a lot of the evidence we have on this suggests that there are much higher returns to the investments that we make early in life. And so after a certain age, attempting to correct for any disadvantage that's generated very early on might be difficult and it might be economically inefficient. So that's on the theoretical side why it's not necessarily clear whether a intervention like this can generate catch-up. But on the other hand, empirically, it might seem like we know a lot about whether we can get catch-up in these sorts of situations, and that the reason it might seem like we have a lot of information is because there are actually a lot of studies that find that early interventions for disadvantaged children generate long-term benefits. So for example, extra care for low birth weight babies, disease eradication programs, food stamp programs in the US, these types of things, we know that they have long-run benefits. But what we really need to know is whether the effectiveness of these programs differs across children of different endowment levels. So if it's higher or lower for those who are disadvantaged early on. That's what we're really interested in here. We're not in terms of this the context of this paper. And it's actually a little bit difficult to get at that, to get at whether the returns differ across different endowment levels. And let me just briefly tell you why. So it seems easy, right? So it seems easy to, because we're really just interested in whether Progresa had larger effects for children hit by a negative shock early on. And so one way, so we can think of four different groups of people, those who were hit by a negative shock. I don't know if this is working, but so there are people who are hit by a negative shock, so that's cell A, and they received an intervention, so in this case we're thinking about Progresa. There are children who received no intervention, so they had no Progresa, but they were also hit by a negative shock. And so to get the effect of Progresa for this group of people, we would just take A minus C. And similarly, for children who were not hit by a negative shock, we would take B minus D, so that, you know, to get the effect of Progresa. And then we could just compare the two. We compare A minus C to B minus D, and that would tell us, does Progresa have larger effects for those hit by a negative shock? The problem with this, there are two problems. So the problem is that children who receive an intervention like Progresa are usually very different from those who don't receive an intervention. And that's due to a number of reasons. That could be because the government targets a certain group of people. It could be because parents need to be aware of an intervention in order to take advantage of it, and the parents that are aware of things like a cash transfer program might be very different from parents who are not. And so these other reasons might be the reason for the difference that we see rather than the program itself. And so similarly, we have another issue, which is that children who are hit by a negative shock are usually very different from those who are not hit by a negative shock. And And so if we want to compare A minus C to B minus D and we find some differences there, that those differences might not be because of the negative shock. It might be because children who are hit by a negative shock are different. They live in different conditions. They have different parents who have different preferences, different environmental conditions, and so on. And so those are other reasons that could be driving any differences we find. And so really what we need to answer this question well is random variation across both dimensions. So we would ideally want an experiment to decide who gets an intervention and who doesn't, and we'd want an experiment to determine who gets hit by a negative shock and who doesn't. And we don't really have that, but we have something similar. So in this paper, what we're doing is we're going to be exploiting two sources of variation. One source of the variation is this negative early life shock. And what we're going to be using for this negative early life shock, by the way, we're in a rural environment, is a rainfall shock. So we can think of rainfall as almost an experiment, because it's a sort of a natural experiment, that generates different levels of, so that generates basically a shock to income, which can be thought of as a shock to nutrition and to health during the early years of a child's life. And what we find actually is that children who are born during good years of rainfall have higher educational attainment and employment probabilities later in life. And for the other dimension, so you know, this experiment that we need to determine who gets an intervention, fortunately we have an actual experiment in this case, because the Progresa CCT program was implemented experimentally for evaluation purposes. So what we find is that children who have more years of exposure to Progresa end up with higher educational attainment and employment probabilities later on. So this cash transfer program worked. And so we have these two separate shocks, and what do we find in terms of their interaction? Well, we find that their interaction is negative. And what does this mean? This means then that Progresa was in fact able to remediate a large fraction of the early life disadvantage generated by these rainfall shocks. And in another way of putting this is that the responses to Progresa are larger for the disadvantaged children. So Progresa helped the disadvantaged children more. And in the paper, we lay out a model to try to explore the drivers of remediation, but I won't be talking about that in this presentation. And so this paper, I think, gives one of the first pieces of convincing evidence for remediation. And the reason it's one of the first is because, as I mentioned, you need kind of two sources, two experiments here, and so it's hard to find a situation in which you have that. And it also contributes to the literature on Progresa, which is a large literature. We found that Progresa has affected a wide range of outcomes, but we don't know as much about its ability of these cash transfers to mitigate shocks, right? So we actually have, there are two papers out there that look at the ability of Progresa to mitigate for shocks that happened at the same time as the program, so these contemporaneous shocks, and there's a little bit of mixed evidence there. What we're doing is we're looking at shocks that happened at the beginning of a child's life, so over a decade prior to the program, and interestingly, we find that Progresa is able to mitigate for those shocks. So I've briefly mentioned the program, but I just want to spend a little bit more time on what Progresa was. It was a conditional cash transfer program that gave money to mothers to incentivize their children to go to school. I believe they had to go to at least 85% of the school days in order to get the cash transfer. And crucially for us, it was implemented using an experimental design. So a randomly selected half of the villages got the program in 98, and the other half of the villages got it at the end of 1999. Did I do that? Sorry. And this generated, as you can see in this table, this generates variation. So this generates a variation in the number of years an individual was exposed to Progresa based on whether they were in a treatment village or a control village, but also based on how old they were when the program came in, right? That would determine how many years you got of the program. And so we're going to be using all of that variation. Now, we're going to be using the baseline and the 2003 surveys from this evaluation, and we're going to be focusing only on eligible households. So Progresa was targeted already to a disadvantaged group, so it was targeted to poor households below a certain income level, and so So we're going to only be focusing on those households. So we're really looking at a disadvantaged group within an already disadvantaged group. So for rainfall, I just want to make it clear why we're interested in rainfall. We're not interested in rainfall as rain. We're interested in rainfall as a shock to income early in a child's life. And there's previous work out there in these same villages that finds that rainfall kind of rainfall of both extremes, so a lot of rainfall and too little rainfall can affect expenditures, household expenditures. And so based on that, we're going to be using a similar variable to capture that. So we're going to create an indicator for whether the rainfall in an individual's year of birth was within one standard deviation of the locality average. So the idea is that we're going to call something a good rainfall year if it was about average for your location. So if it's a particularly wet area, a wet average would be considered normal, and then in a particularly dry area, a dry average would be considered normal, but anything even drier than that would be considered a drought, and anything a lot wetter would be considered a flood. And so the reason we do that, again, I mentioned, is because there is another paper that already looks at this issue, but also we can show here in using our own data that we use in the paper that wages are kind of related to these rainfall variables in the way that we expect. So wages are a lot lower at the tails of the distribution, so where the negative 2 is represents a drought, the positive 3 represents sort of floods, so you'll see that wages are lower in those when in areas where that had rainfall of those extremes, and then kind of higher when you have rainfall about average for your location. So the first thing that we do is we're using rainfall because we think it affects income and we think income affects nutrition, but the first thing we want to do is check whether this might actually be the case. So what we do is we look to see whether rainfall shocks in the year of the survey are related to nutrition indicators. And we do find that rainfall, so if you have bad rainfall in the year of the survey, this leads to lower BMI, measured again in the year of the survey. So there's this kind of contemporaneous nutrition link. We also find that rainfall shocks in the year of birth, so this is looking at children and linking rainfall to their year of birth, this is associated with higher rates of stunting for children 2 to 8, and interestingly also higher rates of behavioral problems for children 8 to 10. So there appear to be physical as well as some non-cognitive effects of these income shocks. Now, moving on then to our main analysis, our empirical specification is, when I apologize, I present this a lot to academic economists, so they like regressions and they like the taste. So you'll see some tables with lots of numbers, but they're probably not all that interesting to many of you, but I'll breeze through them. So what we're doing here is regressing our outcomes of interest, our educational outcomes, on the number of years of exposure that you were exposed to Progresa, and then a rainfall shock dummy, and then their interaction. So that's essentially what we're doing. And here is a graphical illustration of our results. What we have here, so the solid line in the middle, that's for the whole sample, and that's plotting the relationship between rainfall in your year of birth and the years of education that you receive. So you'll see there's this inverted U shape. So children who were born with kind of around average rainfall, they got higher educational attainment than children who were born in times where there was very low or very high rainfall for their area. So that's the inverted U shape that you see. Now I also separate this for treatment and for control villages. So for children, so the treatment line is the dotted line on top, and the control line is the little dotted line on the bottom. And you'll see, first of all, that the treatment is above the control throughout the entire distribution. So Progresa worked, right? This means that people who got Progresa earlier had higher educational attainment later on. And we actually knew this from a lot of other studies. But the interesting thing here, I think, is that the treatment line is a lot flatter than the control line. So you'll see that it seems like Progresa lifted up the tails of the distribution by more than it lifted up the middle. So this again is the remediation that I was talking about before. So if you look at, these are the coefficient numbers if you're interested in it, but the bottom takeaway is that each year of Progresa exposure mitigated about 20% of the negative impacts of rainfall at birth. And so this just shows you everything in regression form, and just to show that in addition to educational attainment, we look at grade progression and appropriate grade completion as well, which are, I think, a little bit better suited to adjust for age. So grade completion and grade progression is just whether you progress through five grades between 98 and 2003, and then appropriate grade completion is just whether you completed the appropriate number of years of schooling for your age. So if you're 7 years old, you should have completed 1 year, 8 years old, 2 years, and so on. And so here, what we're doing here is just to break everything down by grade. So we're looking at completion of 3 years of school, 4 years of school, 5 years of school, and so on. And what we're seeing here is that most of the effects start to kick in kind of in middle school. So sixth, seventh, eighth grade, these are where we're really seeing these types of effects that we're talking about. And that is consistent with a lot of the existing knowledge out there that, you know, that's a crucial time in these rural Mexican areas where a lot of kids drop out of school. And finally, we would love to look at longer term outcomes, but and there is a 2007 wave, but it, unfortunately, the attrition is so high we can't really use it. But what we can do is we can look at the oldest children in our sample, and we can look at what are they starting to do kind of right around the time they're supposed to be graduating high school and getting jobs. And we can look at whether they're currently enrolled in school, having had a high school degree, whether they're working now, whether they're working in a non-laborer job, so that's kind of trying to separate spot laborers from more formal jobs. And we see that, so here we have a much smaller sample size, so a lot of our standard errors get a lot bigger, but we see that the same pattern of results where we see positive effects of Progresa and then a negative interaction, right? So we see the same thing happening for employment outcomes. So it's not just these educational outcomes, but it's also what happens after that. We interestingly don't find any effects on test scores, but that's actually kind of what most of the literature has found, no effects on test scores in this case, which could be a sign that this schooling is not leading to better test scores in this context. But it also, so there are also though a number of issues with the test score data, so there seems to be some selection into who took the test scores and so on, so I don't want to put too much emphasis on that. These are somewhat boring points. If you want to look at them, that you can see them in the paper, but our results are robust to a number of alternate specifications that we might be concerned are could be driving our results instead of the story that I'm telling here. And finally, it doesn't seem to be the case that fertility is changing or that attrition is the reason for what we're finding in our results. And so just to wrap up, so I think really the bottom line of this paper is that the effects of Progresa were the largest among the most disadvantaged. And this highlights the importance of targeting disadvantaged children, even in a context where we're already targeting a poor SNP population. And this, again, I think it's kind of an optimistic result because it tells us there is quite a large potential for mediation, at least in this context. The theoretical work that we do in the paper suggests that the ability, so the reason Progresa is able to remediate in this way is because of how it affects cost differently for low endowment and high endowment individuals. And I'd be happy to talk about that more if anyone's interested. And finally, I want to state that this is certainly a context-specific result. There's no way we can say, you know, cash transfers always generate remediation. It's certainly context specific, but I do want to mention that cash transfers and rainfall shocks are very common and becoming more common, I'd say, at least for the cash transfers, in the developing world. So a study like this does still have a high degree of external validity. Thank you so much for listening.
Thank you, Dr. Molina, for your presentation. For the last presenter, may we have our visiting research fellow here at PIDS, Dr. Paqueo.
education system, although we're going to say something about in a comparative style the high school education, but the focus is on higher education system. Okay, so and we link this to the forthcoming sometime in September conference that the IDS will be holding called the Harnessing the Fourth Industrial Revolution. So, but that is just the setting. I'm really focusing on the higher education system and focusing on some policy issues. So, just to introduce the context, scientific knowledge and its innovative applications have become today fundamental drivers of social and economic progress. Various labels have been used to describe this historical development. PIDS like to use the acronym FIRE for Fourth Industrial Revolution. So the title actually of my presentation is Unlocking Filipino Potential in the Age of FIRE. It's more sexy. Towards greater inclusion, efficiency, and freedom of choice. That's the theme of our presentation, which by the way, this presentation, I'm just a spokesperson. I'm actually working on this. There's really from two studies that is ongoing with Dr. Orbeta over there and Dr. Mike Abrigo. Stand up, please. Thank you. So with the fusion of digital revolution and other radical advances in robotics, artificial intelligence, 3D printing, biosynthesis, and other domains, FIRE will create unprecedented opportunities for wealth creation and social progress. They need to carry out, what we are saying from the literature and from the past, countries like the Philippines will not automatically enjoy the fruits of the Fourth Industrial Revolution. They need to carry out in earnest effective adaptation measures in education and other multi-sectoral domains to harness the promise of FIRE and minimize the adverse or possible adverse consequences of disruptions, because there will be the risk of that. So the known challenges of the Philippine education system, you know already. I will just go through them very quickly. So low learning achievement, need to improve quality of education at all levels. About half of Filipino students fail to complete the basic education cycle, as I mentioned earlier. High demand for tertiary education, inequality of opportunities, leaving behind poor and marginalized students, which were the topics of the two previous presentations, essentially, and the need to adapt the challenges of FIRE and harness it to achieve the SDGs in the Philippines. Now, our presentation focuses on three interrelated topics. First, the importance of accounting for education spillover effects or public benefits, and their interaction with labor market conditions. Second topic, the policy and budget implications of these spillover benefits. I also use the word in the literature, externalities, and the interaction with the general economic development conditions. And third topic, the need to clarify the roles and markets the roles of markets and government in the finance, provision, and governance of Philippine education system, given the need to be efficient, equitable, and adapted to the fourth industrial revolution. So that is a very very important this adaptation idea. So drawing from our ongoing higher education studies that I mentioned earlier, we seek to develop this policy hypothesis or conjectures. First, the societal returns to education are high, but could rise with the fourth industrial revolution. However, realization of such returns will not be maximized if the government fails to concomitantly put a suitable ecosystem in place, which includes policy, regulations, etc. Third hypothesis or conjecture about normal higher investment in education will be helpful and probably desirable during the transition period towards a new normal under fire. But it is critical that simultaneously education resources be allocated and used efficiently and equitably. Third topic, government and education stakeholders together need to, one, develop a systematic and informed view of the future of Philippine education system, because we feel that they're all over the place. Second, be judicious in prioritizing use of education subsidies, especially in the light of the so-called free college education that's linked to the subsidies of enrollment in HUCs. Third, have a more informed and realistic view of the economics of education, and we focus on this because politicians, including congressmen and senators, think there is no budget constraint. Okay, so the system, the higher education system in the Philippines is grounded on the Constitution. So, just to emphasize something in the Constitution, the vision recognizes that it is the natural right of individuals, and that the private sector is indispensable, because in bringing about the mandated objectives, because the public or the government cannot do it alone, either for practical reasons regarding financing and provision. And the state recognizes the complementarity roles of public and private institution in the educational system. So now let's go to some empirical realities. First, the private education really complements government efforts to achieve its objectives. And you can see this from the share of the private institutions in total enrollment. So it accounts now for about 54%, but it is declining, as you can see from there, from 73% long time ago percent to 54%. So we ask the question, will it end up, that trend, for the there is that concern that if it follows the trend in high school, where before it was like 54%, now it's just, as you can see there, 18%. So the question, will it follow the same trend? No, the tertiary education. So will higher education, a private higher education, become a boutique kind of higher education institutions? So what's the vision? You ask the question. Now private HEIs appear. Another reality is that public HEIs appear to be more cost effective than public HEIs. So we look at the cost per student of private education, and the average per student cost of delivering higher education is very much higher in public HEIs. Yet, when you compare some indicators of quality, let's say average faculty, average professors of the HEIs with masters or PhDs, you will find that private sector is either better in that indicator of quality than the public sectors. And you can see this later. But if you compare also the passing rate in the examination, in licensure examinations, and there are maybe, 35 or 40 of those, and you take the average, you'll find that the sectarian private HEIs is significantly above the HUCs, and the non-sectarian HEIs, okay? So, in other words, and we will see this again, there will be some additional evidence that the although unit cost for HUCs are higher than the private HUCs, that in fact the private HUCs on the whole, this is we're talking averages, are doing either the same or better in terms of some of our indicators of quality, of performance. So that shows you what I was telling earlier about if you compare the average proportion of faculty with graduate degrees by type, right? So the blue line tracks the private sectarian colleges, HEIs, and then you see the two lines, the green and the red, the overlap. So they are close to each other in a sense. Okay. Now, the other thing to note is also that the HEIs, private HEIs, contributes 50% as major providers of professionals in agriculture, business administration, information technology, etc. Private HEIs also account for majority of the centers of excellence and the centers of development. Okay, this is your scatter diagram that shows the in fact, first thing, main point is there is diversity. Okay, as you expect from a system which is a mixed system that is driven by competitive markets, and at the same time with the higher education, public higher education systems. So the thing to note here is that in terms of this graph where you have two indicators in the sense of quality, the passing rate, and the passing rate over there, and the average, the quality indicator for faculty that you have on that northwest block, you have their UP, you have Ateneo, you have La Salle, and down here, we don't want to name names, so lagging behind, and you'll find that actually they're also all over the place. You know, there's no monopoly by the sectarians or the for-profit. You know, it's as I was saying, if you have this type of market, the private sector, for example, actually tries to serve different clientels who can afford different fees. So you will expect that diversity. So, diversity, we are writing that diversity, okay, has strengths and weaknesses, your system. In terms of strength, private HEIs, one, have an incentive to be efficient, flexible, and responsive to students' variety of interests. People have different passion, abilities, and economic circumstances. Second, private HEIs encourage competition of ideas and search for new solutions to problems. And third, reduce what we call the risk of groupthink or confirmation bias. Or in other words, if you only have issue C's, government run, you start to think like a bureaucrat, maybe. So in other words, this diversity encourages different ways of looking at things and not be kind of blindsided into one ideology. But there are weaknesses that comes with this diversity in our higher education system. The proliferation of low value for money, or what we call here diploma mills, due to asymmetric information, which means that students do not lack the information to make the informed judgment. They have more the providers have more information than the students, their customers. Therefore, some of them could be victims of fraudulence, or sometimes they are not able to make the proper choices of what really interests them, and so on. Now, another set of empirical realities of Philippine education is that is shown in in this table, which this is how much the Philippines, the Philippines as a country, spend on education as a proportion of GDP, and it includes both the government expenditures and the household expenditures. In other words, I think for the first time we kind of have this information that basically shows that if you combine both the household and the government expenditures, our expenditures is actually about a little over 6%. But about only 3.3% as a percentage of GDP is funded by government. In case of higher education, it is 87% is funded by household, very dominant. And then for basic education, it is 33%. For a total of the public-private sharing, of the expenditures, about half-half. Okay, you have percent of government of the total is 51% for public, and about 49% for household expenditures. So then another sort of facts that we would like to show you is this kind of simulation exercise, very simple one, that shows how much what would be the savings to the government in terms of finance if the private higher education system is not there to mobilize and provide the higher education to the students, to the population. And it is quite, of course, substantial if you try to project it to, let's say, 2025, or now it's about 147, about that billion per year. And if you project that further, you know, with the growing growth of population, it will be about close to 200 billion. So if the government wants to take over because of, for ideological reason or whatever, then it will have to shoulder that much financial burden, which means taxpayers will pay more. Okay, so another set of empirical realities relates to the social and private rate of returns of higher education. By societal, we mean the returns to education, that is the individual returns to education, plus the returns that goes to society, the rest of society as a whole, because of so-called spillover benefits that actually is not part of the calculation of the individual students making the decision to go to college or not. So that if you don't include that, basically society will be underinvesting, because the reward to the individual, the student making the decision, will not take into account the benefits that the rest of society actually are gaining. Now, I'm not going to discuss the details of this, but maybe later, if somebody will ask the question, we will tell you our magic, secret magic. But here, what I will just point out is that if you look at the under what is called societal, that's the total public and private, so extended, that's using the so-called instrumental variable, what you'll find is that the high school has a societal rate of return of about 24% per year, while the college education is 17, okay? But if you look at the private only, which is the usually what is being measured, what you'll find is that the under the extended IV, it's low, the private, 2.8, okay, and versus 9 for college, but the public is the reverse, which means that from the social point of view, the high school has a high return, but low return to the individual. So the individual incentive is modest, I should say not low, but modest, but high return to society. The reverse for college is true, which is high private rate of return, but still okay, but relatively low compared to, I mean, relatively lower compared to high school. So, if it is still worthwhile, the general sort of to invest in both college and higher education. But the question is, suppose you are constrained because of fiscal constraints, limitations. How would you allocate your limited resources? So you'll basically have a strategy which says basically, well, there's enough incentive. We will subsidize some extent college and of course high school. But the question is, where do you focus? Okay. In this particular case, then you will say you'll maximize social well-being if you focus on the high school, right? Because it has a high social rate of return, and it needs to be incentivized so that families will spend their time encourage them to go to college, to high school, to complete their high school. But the opposite is true, that basically says, you know, maybe in college, there is a high rate of return to college education to the individual, and maybe they don't need as much, okay, sort of incentive. What may be needed there is how to facilitate their ability to pay, because there is liquidity problems. You cannot borrow because of capital markets imperfection, which we are going to discuss later. So now, the next slide. Okay. What I want to show with this slide is that there is heterogeneity, meaning the rate of return varies according to the circumstances or the local markets where the workers are in. Now, but what I want to show here is the following, that the impact of high school, the so-called social effect of the aggregate total capital stock of education, let's say in the province, okay, in an area, in a local market, is negative, okay? Okay. And for those here in the informal sector market, job market, and also in the second to sixth class municipalities, okay? So what does that mean? Basically, it seems to suggest that you could basically displace if you expand high school, particularly if it does not increase really productivity that a lot, that what would happen is that you might be just substituting, displacing those without high school education, okay, and with that displacement, lower, put it another way, there's too much supply of high school educated, it depresses the wage rate of the less educated, okay, when there's too much in the aggregate, in a market where basically are not progressive, okay, and dynamic. Because if you can see, first class, this first class province, there's no negative. It occurs in the poorer provinces, okay? And here, if you're stuck in the informal sector and you cannot go to the formal job, get formal jobs, and you don't have high school, you will be, the wage rate, the earnings there will also be depressed. And those that have lower levels of education will be at adversely affected. Okay? So, this is related to what we know in the 60s or 70s as education inflation or displacement. Okay, so the point here is this, that failure to maximize returns to education investment can occur due to lack of, let me see, is it there? No. Yeah. There, at the top. So, failure to maximize returns to education investment could occur due to lack of complementary development in disadvantaged labor markets. So, I think to make sure that your investment in education will generate very important externalities or benefits, that there should be a complementary development interventions that are effective in making the economy more progressive. So very important, the coordination. Okay, now, then we have this finding. Okay, so we look at also the rate of return of higher education, college education, comparing those that graduated from issue 6, sectarian HEIs, non-sectarian HEIs. Okay? So what do we find? Essentially, using the so-called Mincerian equation, we find that the sectarian, the graduates of sectarian HEIs have a way higher rate of return compared to the issue C graduates and the non-sectarian, the non-sectarian HEIs. But the non-sectarian HEIs and the graduates of issue C, they have more or less the same rate of return. But all of them have high rate of return, so we'll see later. But you will find that the sectarian private HEIs have roughly double the rate of return of the graduates of issues and the non-sectarian HEIs. But when you compare the graduates of issues and non-sectarian HEIs, they're more or less the same. Maybe the for-profit or the non-sectarian, just a little bit more. But basically, more or less roughly, they are the same. So I say, well, after all, the much maligned non-sectarian actually compares well in terms of their rate of return. Compares well with HOCs. Now, so that's the regression equations that we estimated. So here, one controls for, that's why this, the coefficients here are lower, because here we control for the characteristics of the fathers, the socioeconomic background of the fathers. Okay. So even if you control for that, you'll find that it is quite substantial, about 50%. For private sectarian, but the private non-sectarian is about 37%, but an issue C is about 34%. So, remember, higher rate of return, less cost, unit cost, that's the picture that you get compared to issue C's. Now, then who benefits? Okay, first, this is just the net enrollment rate by deciles. Okay, everybody know what a decile is, right? Just raise your hand if you don't. Okay, so you'll expect it monotonically increasing. Now look at this. We looked at the distribution of enrollment by deciles. Okay. What you'll find is this. The middle class, if I call this the middle class, is the one that is benefiting, really. If you have 10% here as equal share, right? So ideally, if you have 10% as equal share, because these are deciles, what you'll find is the bottom three has less than 10. So they are disadvantaged, right? And you look at the upper, the two richest deciles, you'll find that they're also less than 10%. And that's because they moved to the private sector. In effect, this benefiting the middle class. When they move out from the HFCs, because these are the HFC enrollments, okay? This is the private enrollment. So what this is saying is the middle class is benefiting from the subsidies of HFCs at the expense of the poorest of the poor. It's very clear. So talking about the Public Act, what is that? Universal free education tuition. The government has to think about that. Why is that important to file? Because if you're not careful, if you don't focus right, you don't prioritize right, these same people who are now disadvantaged educationally will be even left behind economically when the fourth industrial revolution really comes in force. Okay. So now, so these empirical patterns they just mentioned raise questions about the need and means to improve the share of the poorest in education benefits, and raise questions about issues on how to reduce the risk of the higher education system exacerbating social divisions and welfare losses from underdeveloped talents among the children of the poorest. That's why I was glad that the two previous speakers focused on the topics of their choice. Okay, so we went on to basically raise the question, what we call the fundamental analytical and policy questions. So given limited resources, how are the resources going to be allocated between education and other needs? Second, would free enterprise and freedom of choice lead to maximum social well-being and not just to the maximization of the profit of individual enterprises and individual consumer welfare? Third, if so, under what conditions would individual choices and competitive markets lead to maximum social well-being? And fourth, given its resource constraints, how should the country's public-private higher education system be developed to achieve its educational goals efficiently and equitably, thereby maximizing social well-being. So those are, I think, the broad questions that government and us as a society must be thinking about paying attention. And not indulge ourselves with the notion that there is no budget constraint. No, because we were told, you know, when we said this will be, Dr. Orbeta and I were in the Senate hearing, and basically we said, well, you're going to take away the money from the subsidy from the poor to finance the better off. And he said, no. This, you don't have to do that. We have the money. So, just to maybe... okay, this is just the kind of the system, Philippine system, as a whole. It describes the market mechanism, the supply, demand, and what are the problems, causes of market failures, and suboptimal results. And the suboptimal results has to do with what we call the externalities, which I mentioned already earlier, which means that we will be under in investing if we don't take into account in terms of the policies and strategies the public benefits that that an individual person making a decision to go to college or not would benefit the rest of society. So then you have the inequality. If you have, if the country you cannot tolerate the inequality and the poverty, then that's also a cause for regarding the results of the working of the system to be suboptimal. Then you have information asymmetry, which I already mentioned. And then you have the capital market failures, in the sense that, you know, there are no, there are so-called missing contracts in the market that would allow you to borrow against your future income, and therefore you don't have access to finance your education now. Which means that even if you're a bright guy, you're really talented, you want to study, but you cannot, you don't have the liquidity, you don't have the money now to be able to finance your college education, then you will be underinvesting in your education. And who are those people usually? Well, they are even the well-off. They may have problems with liquidity, but particularly the poor and the marginalized who have difficulty accessing financial markets, they suffer most in terms of their ability to invest optimally in their education. So, okay, so let me then summarize the so far. Let me summarize our empirical and analytical findings. One, in a competitive market economy, individuals and private enterprise left to their own devices maximize their own as well as society's well-being under certain conditions. I mentioned those conditions there. But these conditions are generally violated in important ways by market imperfections previously mentioned. But, and this is a very important caveat, but as there are market failures, there are also government failures and inefficiencies that should be balanced against the imperfections of the free enterprise model. Okay. The point HAI system actor has roles to play and has capabilities and limitations. For example, private HAIs tend to be more cost effective, we mentioned, in providing education than public HAIs. Self-regulation and institutional autonomy of both private and public HAIs are good practices, but oversight and regulatory actions or regulation by government are needed to complement the self-regulating advantages of a competitive free enterprise system. The principal message is then this, that the country would be better served if it avoids an either-or solutions to its education challenges and should instead focus on harnessing the strengths of the public and private providers in the higher education system and minimize their weak points. In other words, the idea, the strategy should be to find complementarities and synergies and collaboration between the public and the private sector instead of the public HAI substituting, which is what it is doing, in favor of public provision. Okay, so I think that I'm down to now. So there are what we are planning to do in our final report is essentially to deal with the following issues and potential policy recommendations organized into three pillars. The first pillar is about finance, which will deal with policies, regulations regarding subsidy, tax, exemptions, which is now being discussed under Train 2, fees and cost recovery, and student loan and repayment, and the underinvestment in research and development. Second pillar is the provision of higher education, which includes issues relating to quality, cost effectiveness, inclusiveness of public and private HAIs, freedom of choice, effectiveness of R&D, and other issues. Governance relates to the need to level regulatory burden because the burden, the regulatory burden on HUCs and LUCs, they're very light, really. But the burden on the private sector is, they've been complaining, is quite unfair and heavy in many cases. So, the need to level regulatory burden and access to subsidies by private HAI students and availability and accessibility of information, because to address asymmetric information issues. For students to make informed choices, for HAIs to be accountable to students on their deliverables, and two, for taxpayers to ensure the education subsidy support is worth the support. And third, for government to strengthen cost-effective oversight and regulation of HAIs. Now, the core ideas that we are proposing for a policy framework looking forward, the main idea of the proposal is to adjust some current rules and practices in ways that would enable and motivate higher education stakeholders to do their best in the roles that are most suitable to them. Consequently, we seek to promote measures that use public and private inputs as complements rather than substitutes, while maintaining constructive market competition among public and private HAIs. Third, in so doing, we leverage strengths In so doing, we leverage strength of private HAIs and reduce the risk of over-reliance on government for financing and provision of college education. Then, related to this is diversity in provision has its strength. Fourth, essentially, we will not discuss that. Those are details in terms of what the specific policies that we are entertaining and the strategic actions. But let me just mention too. I think that it is time to take Unifast law seriously. Meaning, in the Unifast law, the idea was to provide assistance of two types. One is granting aid assistance, and the other one is like merit scholarships. Okay? And that this would be portable. These are subsidies that would be that rather than be tied to public issuers in the form of this tuition fees, that they will be given, it says, vouchers to targeted students, eligible students, and they will be free to choose which HEI they would like to go to enroll in, that will fit their interest, their passion, their talent, their capacity, and you know their sense of whether those HEIs will deliver their deliverables. Okay, so in other words, let there be some kind of competition, but it will be student-centric. So that's one. The second, to complement that, is then increase the share from almost nothing of what we call the disposable types of subsidies from maybe 1% to maybe 10, 15%, so that's one way that the system could be made more efficient and responsive and flexible to the changing demands of the market. With that, thank you very much.
Thank you so much for that extensive presentation, Dr. Paqueo. Now we proceed to the open forum. Okay, but before you ask the question, kindly state your name and the office or the agency you're representing. Okay, so who would like to ask the first question? By the way, we have mics there at the back. Question, please. Yes, Mr. Acosta, for the first question.
So thank you. Now I think I have to do something. No, at least I can comment. No, I want to especially congratulate the speakers. I have a comment on the paper first of Teresa, which I find fascinating. I want to read it carefully and understand all the methodology. But I feel that there is a lot of resonance, as you may imagine, with the case and agenda in the Philippines. No? And this is something that we should try to exploit of a way to replicate. We have discussions at the World Bank with ESWD, not only the implementation of the conditional cash transfer program, but also in the area of disaster response and how to use social protection as a disaster response tool. Philippines is one of the countries that is in a unique position, one for fortunate reason, we have a very large national coverage of cash transfer program at the CCT. An unfortunate reason, but in the reality is the exposure to natural disasters. And that's how, you know, this makes sense to converge these two elements and analyze how the cash transfer can have in the past and can enhance resilience in the future. So the natural obvious case here was when Yolanda typhoon happened that about 1.5 million families were affected in total, indirect or directly affected by the typhoon, and a large proportion of the poor were covered by the CCP top up. So that could be a question that we have been thinking about, whether there is a way to analyze with existing data, and that way we want to discuss later separately. But also thinking of the future, there have been other events where the country has had the opportunity. In some cases, we have to admit that in the last 2 years, probably did not follow the example as it happened with Yolanda, but there have been a lot of cases where there was a rationale for using cash transfer programs. And this is, again, the policy discussion, and being here in PIDS, we would like to, of course, partner with our thinking, how the Philippines can move to a more comprehensive framework using social protection for disaster response, and the analysis like what Teresa is presenting is very relevant. Okay? So I want you to put it on the table, and maybe some others can reflect on that as well. On Vic, I think I open it, I think your message is very conclusive on your opinion on the free tuition possibilities. I see, of course, that there are a lot of analysis done similarly for other countries. I see the trend in the Philippines is very remarkable. I didn't know that enrollment in private higher education institutions were going down, and it would be very important to understand what is behind that. But certainly, it requires a very careful and deep analysis before taking a decision to move into something that will compromise a lot of the public resources in the future. So the question again is, are there other options? Because of course, there is something that you haven't mentioned so much, which is, one is the picture today. So this proportion of the upper cantons going to the higher education, but the other thing that we haven't discussed is the very low proportion among the poor families, not going today, either private or public, into higher education. The question is how we can increase that. And again, is this something that should be done through subsidies, through loans? What are the options that the country has in order to boost that? Now, on the fourth industrial revolution, you haven't talked much. I thought that from the presentation, you were also going to talk about the careers of the specialization and what are the mega trends that are emerging, which we can have a separate conversation, because the bank has been doing a lot, and it's actually the World Development Report of the World Bank this year is about the future of work, and reflecting a lot about these trends towards automatization, what are the competencies and the skills that may be required in the future. And I want to also put this on the table as a piece of advertising of the report that Takiko did as well on the socio-emotional skills, that this is a very recent report. We launched it at the end of last year, where we were welcome to present again in PIDS if needed, and there is interest. Because one of the things that the uniqueness of the particularities of the Philippine economy is orientation towards services. And this is, of course, the services that require more human interaction and will, of course, require more social-emotional skills are areas that there is an opportunity to develop further in the country. So these are type of jobs that will be probably less likely to be automatized in the future as compared to the manufacturing routine type of work. No? So that to put it in there in the agenda, again, I think it's, there's a lot of discussion, and we as a bank would like to partner with all of you, the PIDS, those who are attending, and also academics, brilliant academics like Teresa, to further investigate this on this aspect.
Let me
Thank you
very much for your just invite you to attend September 26th. July 26th? No, the APPC.
September 19th.
September 19th, which is the annual
a public policy conference, which is devoted entirely to the fourth industrial revolution. And with the various dimensions, providing the technological landscape, and what are some of the socioeconomic consequences and risks, but opportunities also. First opportunities, and then what are risks, and what are, how can we move forward? Those will be the themes. So.
Yes, sir.
Philip Parnell from Sydney Neotech. Thanks for all the speakers for very thought-provoking presentations. Just some comments to a couple of the presentations. First, the presentation on the ALS. As you know, I've been working in this area for some time. And it was not apparent from the presentation, but I think it's important when we do any research or analysis on the ALS, it's important to understand the context of the learning system within the bigger educational structure. The ALS, as you described it, was developed with funding assistance from the ADB with a massive financial investment in between 1995 and 2001, $30 million investment, which actually helped establish the system components. So the curriculum, the learning delivery system, the learning materials, the assessment and certification mechanism, and the support structures which surround it. So that's what your study has analyzed 20 years later, what actually happened. But after that initial investment from the bank, which was ADB with a counterpart from the Philippine government, there has been virtually zero investment in the alternative learning system. And so after, it's been stagnating essentially for 20 years. And so a system which was developed and with great fanfare and achieved great success, I think in the year 2000 it won the Nobel Literacy Prize for Innovation of UNESCO. So that was at its pinnacle. But then the subsequent underinvestment. So we're at this point in time, out of the total education budget of the Philippine government, if we were to look at the taking your 6 million people, assuming your 6 million is accurate, this is a question mark. So assuming that 6 million people are the potential clients of that alternative learning system, and there are annually about 20 million students in the formal school system, you would expect that's representing about 20% of the total student population of the country. But the total percentage of budget allocation to the alternative learning system is far from 20%. 0.01%, so less than a tenth of a percent of the total education budget. So there's this great imbalance between on the demand side and the supply side of the alternative learning system. The resources are not there to support the necessary supply requirements of the system. So that's just the first thing. The second would be that after 20 years, finally, under this administration, there's an overhaul of the alternative learning system. But it's not clear what the implications of that overhaul will be, because the curriculum, which will be relaunched, officially come online 1st of January next year, radically changes the underlying philosophical underpinnings of that ALS. And it will require massive investment to put in place the necessary other support pillars, the learning materials, the capacity building of the teachers will have to implement that new curriculum, the learning environment necessary to support the new curriculum, the assessment and certification system needed to provide the necessary quality benchmarks for learners who exit from the system. At this point, there is no, the World Bank is not there, the ADB is not there, there are no donor from the development community who is supporting those investment requirements. On the government side, is actually going backwards. The total budget for the ALS within the Public Department of Education is actually going down. So it seems that there's this contradiction between, this is the time with the new version 2.0, so to speak, which is really trying to address many of the fourth industrial estate competencies, so there's a strengthening of social and emotional skills, strengthening of work readiness skills, strengthening of citizenship preparation skills, strengthening of digital citizenship and global citizenship skills. That's all being done on the curriculum side. But there's no investment on the other components. And so I think this is at a critical point for development partners like the banks and other agencies to have a serious discussion with the Department of Education on what is the long-term public sector investment in alternative learning if we really want to make the S in ALS strong and sustainable and forward-looking. So that would be my comment on the ALS. But I think this is the time for a serious investment, a massive investment on the strengthening the S in the ALS given the new developments. Just a comment, sir, on the presentation on the public-private HEI system. I'm just wondering if your study did any comparative analysis with other countries in ASEAN, Southeast Asia, where the context is somewhat similar in terms of the challenges. For example, comparative countries such as Malaysia, Thailand, where in terms of the public-private mix, because I'm just wondering, is your analysis, is the performance of public sector higher education in the Philippines due to its public character or due to the specific conditions and context of Philippines, of the Philippines? Because if you were to look at Malaysia, for example, I think 95% or almost 100% of the higher education system is public. Likewise in Thailand. Likewise, when you look around other high-performing countries, it's public sector education which is performing well. If you look at the top 300 universities on the top three rank, of that those top 300, about 80% are public higher education institutions. So it's not the fact that they are public per se, but something else. There's something else about it. It's not simply the ownership, but there's some other factor there. And again, looking at comparative, you would see that possibly what is a problem is there are just too many institutions in the Philippines. Why is it in Thailand, which has a population of about 70 million, they only have 50 or 60 universities with teacher education, 60 or so. Malaysia only has about 40. Singapore has one. There's only one university which takes care of all the teachers. Whereas in the Philippines, there's over 1,000. How could 1,000 institutions possibly be produced quality graduates which could be absorbed by the depth ed public education system or the private sector? There's just not enough jobs for that many graduates. So it seems that the macro level structure of Philippine higher education, there's also some structural issues, structural problems. So again, as I said, it would be good to see some comparative research of other countries with similar mix between private and public sector funded HEIs to see to what extent is it the public-private ownership aspect and to what extent is it other contextual factors to do with quality of the basic education preparation system, quality of teacher preparation system, investment in research, investment in learning environments, and so forth and so on. Also, it would be important to look at the role of public versus private education in the Philippines. They are somewhat performing different functions because they have somewhat different mandates because the public higher education system also have an extension service that are meant to have a community extension function, which is by necessary not to do anything to do with economics or anything. So I think there are some aspects having a deeper understanding of what's happening in that public system is necessary, particularly through some comparative studies. Thank you.
Okay. So Ms. Igarashi, would you like to answer the first question?
Talking about the massive investment.
Can I share something?
like I really, personally, I really want to support, but when we look at, you know, educational sector as a whole, many of them are priorities to have many of them go to school, stay in school, and graduate school. So we also had also a discussion when Secretary Williams came, and then one of her major concerns is the AS. But we didn't really win this kind of fight. So as much as we want to support, but also we are supporting the basic education formal system so that eventually the young cohort will be staying in school. The pool of the potential learners for the LS will decline just like other countries. So we are not building the the massive like a parallel path, but instead let's improve the basic education system first. But also, we cannot really leave those who are already in the labor market without any basic education, but how we can address those population. So that's why my presentation also had some cautionary notes that ALS is a very large and complex program in the country already. So anything to do the massive reform, we need to be carefully evaluate. What is the implication to the budget? We also discussed about the higher education budget. It's basic education is already pressing other education factors. What is the implication? We understand the need we share, but I also share also the struggle in the bank. Do you want to add something?
Yeah, to add this. Just of course, this is one of these false dichotomies, no, that only supporting the regular stream and, you know, neglect the ALS or the opposite. I think, of course, the answer is quite obvious, no, that if the country really wants to have a good or the decent quality ALS, needs to be adequate investment. And I think that that's what this study tried to contribute, somehow putting some numbers to your appreciation, which is very clear, no, that there has been, I don't want to see neglect, no, but, you know, there are areas where clearly we cannot ask for improving performance to a system where there is no or very little investment, no? So that's the policy question here for the Philippines, is whether this is something that we want to really take to the next level and to improve really the chances for those who have and already left the school. We need to allocate needed resources. And I think also, again, coming to the question, we don't have a rate of return, so it would be great to have that, no? I mean, I think we didn't have the data enough to go that beyond that, no? But, looking at other countries or trying to argue that this could be also a smart investment, we are not saying that it's the panacea, and actually, you know, the best is could be that the kids stay in school, but you also need to have a response to those who, for different reasons, cannot complete and cannot finish. So, unfortunately, as Takiko mentioned, we did the international review. It's not that there is many studies, especially in developing countries. There are a lot for the U.S., which is a very different country with the GDP, but. That's part of the message as well. We need to try as much as possible to collect hard evidence, and especially for the PED, if the monitoring and evaluation system can be strengthened.
Yes. Yeah, I think that's a very good suggestion. Actually, that's part of our agenda to look at other countries. For example, looking at the their accreditation systems, the information that is being put out there, because that's a big, I think that's a big issue. But I think that we look at also the income contingent loan, about how that could be made feasible, because the big problem, even if it is successful in Australia, there's a problem of replicating the efficiency of its collection mechanism. But maybe you can do it progressively. There are also things that we want to look at, like the comparison of the share of enrollment, because I think they differ very much. Now, but at the end of the day, we need to look at the Philippine realities in the sense of its constraints. The tendency of our congressmen and our idealists is to think that just because Germany is now moving into free universal higher education, that therefore we should, that's the norm, and that we should also follow, forgetting that for God's sake, we don't even have our basic education in place. Or that, or even things on the children, for example. And you even want to defund CCT in order to either put in livelihood programs, short-term livelihood programs, and you know, sort of the other thing that they want to do is to basically argue that, you know, it has no contribution in terms of economic, which is of course false. So that's the kind of mindset I think that we need to kind of have a discussion with policymakers to be realistic. Because when you're talking about Singapore, when you're talking about Malaysia, they are already far ahead in terms of their economic capability and the constraint. So the question for us is, in practice, given this constraint, how can we maximize the effectiveness of our system to reach the goals that we have? And those goals, even if we couch them in universalism, must be set realistically, progressively. No, meaning, I think Bates is a new term for it that he got from, was it the World Bank? Progressive universalism. You don't immediately, in one blow, achieve universal, high-quality college education. Because if you do that, and you don't mind the constraints that you have, you're going probably to sacrifice the education of the poor and the development of very young children in terms of their nutrition, in terms of their brain, in terms of, you know, more fundamental things in life.
Did that answer your question?
Yeah.
Actually, I think there's a need for a follow-up data from your graph. It's a very powerful graph. To me, the most powerful graph that you presented in terms of the argument of the was the graph showing the income distribution
yeah.
of the students in the current SUCs. If I was a congressman who was articulating the free tuition, perhaps my response would be that's the very reason why we need to have
yes.
the two free tuition, because your data was as of 2014, before the free tuition came in, and that's the very reason why we need to have free tuition. The ability to participate in those percentiles. Of course, I know that.
Question is for base.
Of course, I know that there are limits, but you would need to now have a comparative assessment in 2 years' time or next year. Okay, what happened with the free tuition? Did it achieve its objectives? Did people from the fifth and sixth percentiles enter the free SUC? Were they able to benefit? Or all that happened was it subsidized the middle and rich students who were there already. So I guess we would the jury is out to some extent on the effectiveness of it as an equity strategy until we see the data, enrollment data, from this year when we see the enrollment data.
But what we're saying is that, okay, we're not really saying don't have issues, but in terms terms of who will, how do you help the poor, for example, in terms of getting the college education, why don't you give them a choice? Give them the assistance as a vouchers and let them choose. That's the option that they actually was stipulated in the Unipass bill, but they ignored for political reasons to directly subsidize issues is to please the students and the militants.
So, thank you for that, Dr. Paqueo. I saw him. Yes, ma'am.
Bill Cornelio from CPBRD House of Representatives. Good afternoon.
Representative.
So my question is on the ALS study. I'd just like to ask how the ALS budget was calculated. And then number two, regarding your findings on, well, 60% of the cost is paid for overhead. Is it based on GA amount or the actual amount? Because again, it could be a problem of budget execution. Thank you. How is ALS? Number one, how was the ALS budget calculated? And then number two, regarding the basis, the basis for the 60% cost for overhead. Was it based on GA amount or the actual amount downloaded? Because it could be a problem of budget execution.
Okay, so 60% of the cost paid is paid for the transportation. So in this survey module, we didn't really discuss about how much they receive or how much they use out of their budget or anything. But we simply asked, we keep hearing the complaint about the learners or difficulty from the learning facilitators. They don't really have the resource to pay for the paper, for the printing materials, or for the stationery for the learners. So we simply ask what items they actually purchased, and then how much they spend, how frequently they spend. And then we can come up with some actual expenditure per learning facilitator. So we compare the ALS facilitators are given so-called transportation allowance and teaching aid, which are similar to the school MOE, which is given to the school. So we just compare what is the expenditure in relative to the amount they receive in the AA,
okay.
For example. So it's not about the utilization or anything, understanding or anything. We just simply compare how much did they see and actually how much they are actually spending on the ground.
Yeah, the conclusion is basically that it's a shortfall, no? So it's not enough to cover even the basic expenses. Not that basic.
So what's happening is the teachers are subsidizing the system.
Yeah, they are
using their own
the
personal money to pay for the chore, the transport allowance, the printing of the materials, because the total budget allocation is less than 1,000 pesos per learner,
okay,
and it's not enough to cover the system requirements.
Yes.
And they took 35 billion? That's that? From the, they took 35 billion from the debt aid to 30 billion from the debt aid to finance free universal issues.
So yes.
Good afternoon. I'm Edric Calvo from the Knowledge Child Foundation. I would like to ask Teresa, how much is the CCD amount that are provided to the kids in your in Mexico?
I unfortunately don't know that off the top of my head, but I know that it is similar more similar to the Filipino 4Ps program. So it's on the larger end of all of the other traditional cash transfer programs that are out there.
So actually, I have to say, when the 4Ps was designed, was actually very mimic, very closely to the Mexico CCC program. So it's about trying to contribute about 20% That's how it was calculated. But what happened since then? Then when the two programs started to diverge, the CCT program was never adjusted that amount. And of course, this was designed in 2008, we are 2018, so 10 years, calculate inflation between the period. So now our latest estimate for 2015, where we have the data, this instead of 20% of the income of the poor, we are having reduced to 11%. In the Mexico, they tried to raise to keep that according to the 20%. There are other things that have happened, to be fair, in the Philippines, there is now a top up for a rice subsidy of about 600 pesos per month. There is a discussion now about potential compensation through the tax reform, and it's going to be also targeting the CCT family. But to be fair, the amount, the pure amount for the CCT has been frozen since then, and so that's something that we have been also recommending eventually to revise.
Thank you. I was just thinking how much or the quality of CCT as an intervention should be provided to the qualified kids in the Philippines. As I think the kids now would get, or the families with kids, qualified kids would get 500 pesos per month, is it right? So it's around $10 US dollars per month.
And there was, just to add, I happened to depart in the early years of that. The in terms of education, the system covers only the up to 12, the elementary, basically.
Yeah.
Now it covers the whole 4 years. So it's a nice complement, actually, to the K to 12 reform. But I think, as pointed out, you really need to make sure that in real values, it's going to decline.
I also want to add that, at least in the Mexico case, the idea behind the subsidy is that it's helping to alleviate the opportunity cost of time, right? So these kids could be working, they could be doing something else, and you want to be able to, alleviate that and keep them in school. In Mexico, the value of the amount of the subsidy varied for boys and girls because girls were dropping out more, and it also varied as kids got older. So the idea is that, if you're a high school student, you could be getting maybe a higher paying job, so you would need a larger subsidy to keep you in school. I don't know if that's the case with the poor
kids. The boys should get more here.
The boys
because
are
lagging
much
behind in all education indicators.
So for not as I think in Mexico it's each age or each grade, I don't recall, has a different amount.
Yeah.
Here it's by block, right? Elementary, and then high school is 800 and then 500 for elementary. So there is some recognition of that, no?
We are actually on the low side, right?
Yeah. Now
in terms of
generosity,
of the,
yes.
Yeah, in terms of the subsidy that we are giving, they are on the low side compared to all the various countries
Is that because of the real values? Too?
Well, the real value, but even to start with, in the actual that they receive, there was a time that early on, actually, maybe 2 or 3 years, it was just like 9% or 7%.
Yeah.
Bibbs knows this one.
2014 is 9% of consumption.
And in Mexico, is the bulk of the amount would go to the food, or would it go to other?
It's like here, they're free to choose
whatever.
Whatever they want.
Yeah, I mean, the evaluations show that the majority of this money tends to be spent in the obvious things, like food expenses, education, health expenses. These are the things that you were trying to incentivize. So that's what your paper also showed, that there are a lot of research analysis and studies. Actually, there is two very nice collections of papers about CCTs. One is about two different myths. One that beneficiaries spend in vices or alcohol or gambling or cigarettes is actually quite conclusive, that there is no evidence. Of course, most of the CCTs in the world, every
any significant impact. And the other one is about the myth also that the people will stop working because receiving the CCT. The evidence is quite conclusive that it's not happening, especially in those programs where they are not extremely generous. Of course, there were some cases. There was one CCT program in Nicaragua and others like the recall where they have found this type of effects, but these were CCTs that were providing extremely generous benefits. But for the normal, you know, type of CCTs, or even, of course, the case of the Philippines where the amount is very low compared to what of course, there is no effect really found on people becoming lazy because of the program.
So, are there any other questions? Yes, ma'am.
I am Rina from the Knowledge Channel as well, also for Dr. Molina. I just wanted to follow up that question on the CCT effect, no? On mitigating stunting. Is that what happened in, or the result in Mexico?
So the result that I showed had to do with rainfall. Bad rainfall shocks leading to higher stunting rates. In terms of mitigating, in terms of the cash transfer programs mitigating the stunting, there is actually not much evidence on that. In fact, there is a paper we know that actually the conditional cash transfer programs decrease stunting overall, but in terms of mitigating the effects of earlier life shocks, that there's not much evidence there. But the programs are known to have, across the board in Mexico, in the Philippines, to have reduced stunting and improved nutritional outcomes.
Yeah, basically because it's used for food. Would that be the...
That's part of it, but in fact, most of these programs also come with a health component, and so it's hard to separate whether it's coming from increased expenditures on food, or if it's because they're going to health centers more because they have to, or because of vitamins that are being provided at health centers, that sort of thing.
Thank you.
Yes.
So hi, I'm Alexa Carlan. I'm from Save the Children. So I'm just going to jump back to the ALS because it was mentioned that there will be an overhaul of the ALS curriculum. So I want to ask if it includes the K-3 curriculum, because in the areas that we're working in now, we're finding out that children as young as 9 years old are dropping out or out of school and have only experienced some kind of kindergarten. So that's what it's mostly directed. Mr. Ferno, would you like to answer that?
A little bit here. It's a good question because alternative learning in the Philippines, is this a good example of the recommendation earlier in the study from the bank of the need for complementation between alternative delivery modalities and alternative learning system? At the moment, the alternative learning system is targeting predominantly young people 15 years and above. The younger children who are not able to avail of regular schooling are meant to be being responded to by what are known as alternative delivery modalities, of which there are several, which are trying to retrieve them or provide catch-up learning if they're missing several days of instruction during the week, or sickness and so forth. So there is a separate initiative for that. But alternative learning is targeting the older group. I just think, well, I have the microphone. Ask about the conditional cash transfer, bringing together the two presentations. Because in the presentation of Ms. Takiko, she mentioned that one of the main reasons that learners are struggling in their experience of ALS is the opportunity cost. And on the other hand, the CCT is really meant to address opportunity cost. So has there been any bringing together of these two so that learners of the alternative learning system who have to work because by very nature of their experience are able to access Four Peaks, the CCCT program? And if not, are there any plans for extending it?
Pablo is expert on the CCT, but yes. And then also the point about alternative learning system to K-3, I'm personally against, giving the children an option to go to the alternative programs. I think main priority for the government to consider how they can deliver the formal education curriculum to those kids. Maybe alternative delivery mode is a solution. Alternative delivery mode is a school-based intervention. So then the principal in charge of that education district know that where the kids are, which kids are not coming to the school. Then the school is responsible to catch those the children. Instead of going to alternative learning system, which is the adult learning curriculum, it's a self-learning curriculum, it's not suitable for the children to develop the necessary competence and skills required for the K-12 system. Okay, CCP.
Very, very comprehensive report. Actually, the CCP is helping also retain kids in the school, so that's an important thing, so that's one of the modalities. Now, the ALS has been available as one of the options now for the CCT. So, but there are issues, of course, there are issues. One of the issues is, if you understand the mechanics, to get the CCT benefit, you need to basically demonstrate attendance, 85% of attendance in the school. And this is easier in a regular school where everybody takes attendance, there is a system, very comprehensive. In ALS, it has been very difficult to prove compliance because of the difficulties in monitoring and system. So that has been the reality. So, but in theory now, families can avail to demonstrate attendance to ALS in a regular facility, but needs to be endorsed and needs to be certified as well by DEPED that the attendance has been complied with.
Yeah. It's a follow-up on ALS, and maybe if there's no discussion of funding, maybe for research. I think one of the limitations of the research is we look only at what is centrally delivered by DEPED. But there is, as far as I know, a fairly substantial delivery of ALS by local governments using the special education fund. And there's also a substantial delivery with providers, most of which are not captured by the debt. And so I think one is, especially talk of ALS, its flexibility, specificity, the fact that you can't even, how can you get a national database on outsourced for youth is very fluid. But the local government has. So I think a study on what has worked, what has not worked, would be useful because it would complement. The second aspect, which is related to BICS, is you can talk here also of public-private complementarity. Of course, in general, our advocacy is basic education is a government responsibility. It should be both publicly provided or at least funded. But the reality is also, it cannot, no? And even when we advocate for greater budget for ALS delivered by the DepEd, the DBM will say, but you have not been able to spend it, it's not effective. In the meantime, there are other private providers. So the only question later is, give the out-of-school youth a voucher. So that it doesn't always have to be supported by a charitable institution, a faith-based institution and all that. This level of, especially, when you're talking now of this 15, we are not talking here of young people at risk, we are talking of potential that is underdeveloped. Because the motivation to go into ALS is higher for the learner than those who go to regular schools. They won't go into that because it's in a second class already. If they want to do it, it's because it's a second chance, but it should be quality. Now, I feel even while we advocate for greater resources, maybe we need to make the case for it, not only with the gaps, but also with initial good cost-effective practices. That's where I think institutions, including PIDS, including World Bank and others, could contribute to the advocacy.
Okay, thank you. to Quezon City School Division, and then when we asked the number of facilitators, mobile teachers and so on, they have actually double of the what DepEd provides. So where like you can see there is a very big special education fund, you see a better performance and a better supply input. And then also DepEd, maybe as you know, DepEd has unified contracting schemes for the MS. And in our study, we try to also attempt to at least compare the effectiveness of those DepEd delivered model and the DepEd contracted model. We didn't see any significant difference in between two contract types. But if you take that as the unit cost per learner's cost, actually the contract delivered mode is less inexpensive than the DepEd delivered mode. Of course, there is a selection bias because the DepEd service provider tends to work in a location where they can recruit, mobilize more learners to comply with the conditions, and then where the DepEd facilitators are going to the remote and most disadvantaged area where service provider is too costly to go there. So we try to do something, but I think more studies needed. And then I think the role of the service providers can be further explored, in my opinion.
I just want to clarify, I'm not talking of private providers delivering with DepEd money.
Yes, sure.
I'm talking of private providers raising their own funds.
Yes. Okay. So
and not even being served properly by DepEd in terms of exams and
yes.
material. You know, they're already doing their bit. And, somehow, so because
yeah.
DepEd thinks of provision by non-DepEd simply as also funded by DepEd,
sure.
I think we are missing this. Now the voucher issue comes later, meaning suppose the private provider can only spend so much from its own resources, then maybe the other learners can be given a public voucher, which is still different from this. So I'm just saying, let's look at other modalities. There are some initial practices. And because this is going to be a fairly difficult policy and program advocacy issue, but it's needed. Otherwise, even when we worry about higher education, there is this crucial. What's the current statistics about of every 100 who enter grade one? How many finish high school?
50%.
So we're not talking about a 20%. So I think it's a bigger policy question compared. But I can understand the concern about unified cost of money being given. But this one, I think we must make the case that it's a huge cohort. No,
that is why you need to be clear about your financial strategy. If you are in such a, you have this binding constraint, financial constraint. Then, and you know that in a sense, from the social standpoint, improving access and quality of basic education, because you're really falling way, way behind the curve there. Then you focus your subsidy there, develop the, don't do away with the contributions of the fees, etc. Because then you'll have to fill that in from your government tax money, and then you have to it reduces your ability to deal with this issue in the basic education sphere. So what you need to do is precisely to develop, let's say, a student loan system, income contingent or whatever. And if you cannot develop that, but at least don't do away with cost recovery. System. The thing is, how to facilitate it becomes the issue, so that it's not too burdensome, And that's why I am so passionate, because it's the basic education that really gets to suffer from the misguided policy to aid what's happening in Germany. Or Bernie Sanders calling for universal education.
For the last question.
It's not a question. I would like to share that we are, I am Dolor Cardenio from Orbeta Foundation. We are accredited by the DepEd to implement instructional manager when trained by DepEd. We have been implementing alternative learning for 10 years, and we have a very good results. When we started in 2009, out of 30 students, 15 passed. And then in the next year, 24 passed out of 30. We can only finance one class because we only have a very short, small group and very, it is a low funding program. And then school year 2014-2015, out of 30 students, 28 passed the A&E test. And then last up for the past 3 years, 100% passed. Yeah. So I think the what he recommended must be done by your group. Maybe you can look at the other organizations, NGOs, and other groups who are implementing this program. For me, we're trying to assess because we have a very good, really very good teacher. That is, but we have, we are spending more or less 7,000 per student a year. That is our budget. But we integrated two training, value formation, 2 days every year, value for each group of students, value formation and preparation for, it's either entering the university or going to work. That is the training we provided. Outside the class, they attended for more than 750 hours.
Thank you for sharing that, ma'am. Okay. For the last question.
Yes. Hello, good afternoon. I'm Diana Jiscovet from ESDA. I just want to clarify about in Figure 23 about the data. If I'm correct, the 43% of us learners after their studies, they enrolled in TPEP, if I'm not sure, but it's that's 43%. Just want to clarify. And also, I just want to ask, I'm just curious about the study for Mexico. What are those negative shocks? Can you specify the specific negative shocks experienced by the children? Thank you.
To answer your second question, in this, so actually I should say, generally in these research papers, lots of different negative shocks have been studied. In the paper that I presented, we're looking at rainfall. So the negative shock that the children experienced was being born during a year that was particularly bad for rainfall. So they were born in a year where there was not enough rain for agriculture. They were born in a year where maybe floods destroyed crops, and that resulted in lower income for the household, lower nutrition, as I showed, and then that had long-run effects on them when they were in school already. You could see those long-run effects later because we saw that they had lower educational attainment. So that's the negative shock that I'm looking at.
So that concludes our
activity
afternoon. We thank our speakers for their insights and of course for the active participation of our participants this afternoon. See you again in our future activities. But before you go, we request you to please fill up the evaluation sheet and give it to our secretary.